I was, I had a call there that I turned my back for a minute. So did Dennis ask you how many new stewards we have in the class? Anybody consider themselves a new steward?
4 or 5.
That's
good.
How many of the rest of you consider yourself experienced stewards?
Well, I can't even raise my hand to that one.
I don't see any of that either. Okay.
Get burned out so easy.
All right, what we're trying to do in the last few years is we decided because we're losing so many people is that each time we have a meeting, we're going to have some kind of steward training. And believe me, we're having steward training because you need steward training.
Yep.
Anything that I say is not intended to offend you, it's just the truth.
That's true.
If the truth offends you, I'm sorry. Probably the best training that you could get is if all of you could come and sit down in Dennis and my office and read the grievances that come in. Then you would understand why you need training. You would understand why our job is a lot harder than what probably some people think. Some people probably think our job's just to come around about 2 or 3 times a year, smile, shake your hand, say hello, give you a little talk.
That'd be great, wouldn't it?
Boy, life is easy, but it's not. Life is getting harder. Post office is getting harder. When we started out in this business, we could take a grievance that arrived at the office, and by the time we would get it to the arbitrator and we argued before the arbitrator, you would never know that I was arguing the case that I actually had received in the office. Because I can make all new arguments, I can change arguments, I can ignore the stuff that was incorrect, and basically I can just do it all at the arbitration table. Don't work that way anymore, they won't let you do it. I used to be able to silver tongue those people to death. Now you can't even get something in. If you have a document, a legitimate document, you try to get it in. If it's not in the record, they won't look at it, they won't take it. So it's more and more important that you do a better job in order for us to do a good job. So, having said that, what we have brought here is an attempt to have some consistency throughout the country in teaching steward training. The booklet that you have, we simply snatched Joyce Robinson's cover off, and we made a cover for Arkansas. This is the official APWU Shop Steward Training Manual that you're looking at. So we're going to go through this. I don't know if we're going to go through all of it or have time to go through all of it, but we're going to do our best. Talking about coming down here, when Dennis and I were talking about what we're going to do, he said, well, Kerry said that some of them went to the stewards training out in Washington, and I thought, well, hey, that's a good deal, because they were going to come and bring us something, so I thought, well, hey, we're going to get set here, maybe we get taught something. So.
Let me know if you want me to teach.
So anyway, I'll just take up where Tammy started about being a steward. You can be a good steward, you can be a mediocre steward, you can be a bad steward, you can be whatever you want to be, and what kind of steward you become depends upon what kind of dedication and effort you're willing to put into. Everyone in this room has the ability to be a great steward. The problem is finding the time to do it.
Yep.
Some people probably think that we as business agents work 9 to 5. That's not the case. We're in the office when we're not on the road. We're basically in the office 7 days a week, some portion of time, holidays or whatever. Someone called one day and said, I'm sorry to bother you on your holiday. And I said, well, holiday is it? someone else called one Sunday and said, I'm sorry to bother your Sunday. And I said, well, why are you calling me? They said, well, because I knew you'd be there. That's the way it is. Now, I'm not trying to tell you that I'm there all day long on Saturday, all day long on Sunday, but at some portion of the day, I will be there. A few years ago, yes, I was there all day long, all night long, or whatever. About, I don't know how many, when did you get elected?
9 or 10 years ago.
Something. 9 or 10 years ago, I got this fantastically wonderful guy that happened to be a good friend of mine, became my partner, and he basically has saved my life, because he comes in there and he works his ass off. It's a pleasure working with him, and tell you the truth, it probably has kept me around a little bit longer. Because I don't feel like I have to do everything. I don't feel like I have to be in your office all day Saturday and all day Sunday, all day every holiday. And just so you know how dedicated Dennis is, I constantly remind him that since he's commuting, although he has a place in Kansas, up by the office, although he is commuting, he does not have to be at work Monday through Friday. But he goes beyond that. He stays Monday through Friday, and then he stays on the weekend, and yep. I have to keep saying, why the hell don't you go home by the yard? Or something. So, anyway, just wanted to say that I have really enjoyed having Dennis with me, and it has helped me out tremendously, and I certainly appreciate him, and I certainly appreciate the work that he does, because Dennis works his ass off. One of the hardest working business ages in the country. Okay. Getting back to being dedicated and whatever, and I'll give you a little bit of a personal history. When I started out, so you'll understand where I'm going, there's a point to this story. I'm not just up here talking. I'm from Kansas City, Missouri Post Office. I went to work in 1960. That's 60. In case you trying to figure that out, that was a few years back. That was back before there was a national agreement. So I have been here forever as far as the national agreement is concerned. First national agreement was in 71. I became a shop steward in 76 and became a local president in 77, national officer in 78. This job in 1980, and this is where I have remained. Not because this is all I can do, but because this is all I've ever wanted to do. Yes. I didn't want to go to Chicago. I passed up a coordinator's job about 100 times. Didn't want to go to Washington. Passed up all those assistant jobs hundreds of times. Just simply don't want to go anywhere other than where I am. Which leads me back to where I start. I never wanted to be a steward. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to be a postal worker that came to work, did my job, be left hell alone. Until I could go home with my kids, have a good time. And on my day off, I could go out and play golf. And expect the union to take care of things. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, after a while, I realized the union people we had weren't really taking care of things, unless it involved them.
Yeah.
Too much of that we have.
Yeah.
People get involved in stuff that if it affects them, they're all for it. But if it's doing something for somebody else, they don't have time. Well, I'm a person that I will have time for you even if I don't have time for myself and my family. Now, I think I'm a dedicated person. I don't expect everybody to be that dedicated. We don't owe our life to this particular venture. But the point I'm trying to make is you can get out of it what you put into it, and the more you put into it, the more you're going to get out of it. Because APWU has been good to me. I love APWU, and that's why I'm still here. I love working for people, with people. I like helping people that can't even help themselves. But I do get irritated sometimes with some of the people we represent that don't realize what we have to go through. As stewards, that's your challenge, is to do for people that don't deserve to have a damn thing done for them. It's always been that way. It always will be. But anyway, And as I sat around there and I watched stuff happening, and I would say, there ought to be something you can do about that. It didn't happen. So at some point in time, I said something to someone, and they said, well, you make a good steward. I said, no, I don't want to be a steward. And they kept after me for a couple of years to be a steward, and I tell them, no, I will not be a steward unless I can devote all of my time to it. Because I don't think it's something that you can do half-assed. You either have to be committed and really want to do something, or you can do something half-assed. I just never liked to do stuff half-assed. I want to do it, I want to put my whole self into it, or I don't want to be bothered with it. So at some point in time, I gave up my family and I took over my union steward job. And when I say I gave up my family, I don't mean that literally. They just felt like I gave them up.
Yeah.
I worked on the PM, so my wife was mother and father. At time in the evenings, I spent all of my vacation time taking my annual leave so I could go coach my son's ball game. And on the weekends, I coached the basketball league. So, but then at some point in time, it reached the point where that time my life was over. They're gone. I'm back doing this full time. Didn't mean to give you that little history to bore you. But just to let you know that's how things happen.
Yeah.
That's how things come about. If you had told me in 1970 that I'd be standing here today doing this, I'd say, you're just out of your mind. Because when I went to work at the post office, my idea was, I just turned 20 years old, I'm going to work 20 years, I'm going to retire, and I'm going to go play golf twice a day. Go bowling and enjoy life. Didn't happen. So, after I was talked into taking a steward's job against my will, because I really didn't want to do it, but then I did it, it wasn't soon long after that, I was talked into running for president. Didn't really want to do it, but I was talked into it. The next year, they needed somebody for a part-time national officer. I didn't want to do it, but they insisted I do it, so I did it. And then in 1980, we needed a better national business agent. I didn't want to do it, but they wanted me to do it and insisted I do it, so I did it. So that's how I got it. So maybe somebody sitting out here, follow that same path. You'd be standing up here 40 years. All right, enough about me and so forth. After becoming the steward and the local president, I decided that we needed to do a better job at our local, and I'm bringing this up because of this school thing. I decided that there were too many grievances being sent out of our office to the national office that they wouldn't do anything with, and so I said, I think I can do better than that, so I established a local arbitration program and got together four or five good stewards from our local, and we rented us a van and we headed off to the great city of Hot Springs, Arkansas. A little old week-long arbitration school at a motel down here on Central Avenue, talked to Pete Reagan. Was also out of the University of Arkansas. That's how I learned to do arbitration. I learned an awful lot in that week. And what I learned was, if you're going to be good at this job, you got to put an effort into it, or you can just do a half-assed job. Later on, I took some of my people to the Ohio State University of Columbus, Ohio, for a similar class. And also attended the University of Missouri at their education seminar. So, every time you have an opportunity to go somewhere, you can learn something. I don't know who taught it in Washington, but I'm sure they did a bang-up job. The business agent out of Oklahoma, used to be Tom Meyer, he used to put on a week-long arbitration school in Manhattan, Kansas. A lot of people went to that, get a lot out of it. So there's educational opportunities, there's opportunities to be involved, but the problem is having time to do it and so forth. So I know you guys had a great experience. I know you didn't go there and sit around and do nothing, because I know how those places are. I've been to them. And I've taught at them. The National Union puts on arbitration schools. They asked me to help teach that one time when one of the people that normally do it was off, and so I've done that. There's a lot of work put into it. You can learn a lot and so forth. So. All right, let's get specifically on now to this book. What this book is, I'm not trying to take steam away from Joyce Robinson. I just want you to know that this product is not the product of one person. Sat down and said, let me write a book. Fact of the matter is, Dennis and I can sit down and write a book. As a matter of fact, we're being recorded, so I won't say it.
I could turn it off.
People know I say what I want to say, regardless of what, I don't give a shit. Excuse my language for those of you that don't know me. Bullshit's my favorite word. I use that probably more word than any other word in the English language. And that's because I've been dealing with the post office since 1960. You've been dealing with somebody that long, especially now that you're dealing with it at our level, then you know that everything is bullshit. What's going on in the country right now is bullshit. What's going on in labor relations is bullshit. It's just all bullshit. So we just have to do our best to try to counter that bullshit through the grievance machine. That's our job. So, open your book there, the table of contents. These are the table of contents. It's in the book. You'll be able to read this for yourself. And if you don't like the one that says Arkansas on the front of it, you want to get an official one from Washington, you can get one. It's got a green cover, but it's got Joyce's name on it. Other than that, it's the exact same book. So we just thought we'd make you a book and bring it with you, and then you can have the book. We've got to put it up here on the PowerPoint, and you could have sat up there and watched it. We could have not cut down this tree or whatever, but what I found out about trees is they grow back. So, to me, I'm old school. I like to have something in my hand rather than something up on the thing. And I like to have stuff I can go right to where I know where it is, rather than get on this computer and say, where the hell did I move that thing? So, now you have this thing you carry around with you. It has a lot of the subjects there. We can do other subjects. And where I was starting to go before about putting this together, you know, Dennis and I could sit down and we could write a hell of a story. So, we could cover every subject that we've been involved in. This just happens to be a few subjects that they feel necessary to put in the shop steward booklet currently. I'm sure that it'll be changed in the future, stuff will be added, and so forth as new issues arise. So let's turn over here and let's start out with certification of stewards. On page one, I guess. I'll certify it. Right away up front, you can have your shop stewards elected or appointed. So hopefully all of your locals appoint your shop stewards, and we have no elected shop stewards. Do we have elected shop stewards? Anywhere?
Harrison.
Huh? You're an elected shop steward? Elected shop steward? Okay. The problem with elected shop stewards is what?
Management can interfere with elections.
Something worse than that.
Cronyism,
favoritism.
Not necessarily
Something worse than that.
Nobody wants to run for office.
No, the Steward won't do his job.
What was the question?
What's the problem with having an elected shop steward?
Elected versus appointed.
If they're favoritism. Elected,
you have a hell of a time firing them if they're not doing their job.
Exactly.
All right, Ike's right. We recommend do not elect your stewards, because if you're elected, whether you do your job or not, you can't get rid of you. So, we have a lot of areas that have elected stewards. It's in my opinion, just not a good thing to have the stewards be elected. Stewards should be appointed by the local, and that's usually the president with the direction of the board or whatever, because if you appoint the steward, and if the steward is not performing their function, then you can simply not appoint the steward. If you elect the steward and they're not doing their stuff, somebody else has to be appointed to do their stuff, and then if they've been elected and don't do their stuff, you can get sued. So, we just say right up front, best to have appointed stewards versus elected stewards. So.
Well, some locals have a constitution that they can get rid of officers and stewards, but it's a long, sometimes a very long, drawn-out process, and then you're going to get headquarters involved. It's just a lot easier if you're appointed that you can be decertified or unappointed than it is to go through a recall, an election, all that stuff to get rid of them.
Everything is outlined in the contract between the union and management and the contract. Everything that governs your local is in your constitution. So whether you have elected or appointed, that's in your constitution. Your officers are in your constitution. Even if your officers are not functioning, you can't get rid of them. Sometimes what we end up doing is people run and they become the secretary treasurer. And they decide that they don't want to be bothered with all them reports. You know, all them reports will land you in big, big trouble if they don't get filled out.
Yeah.
So therefore, somebody from the local is responsible. If somebody from the local doesn't take over what the secretary treasurer doesn't do, ultimately it's the national union that pays the price. That's why we have all these training sessions for secretary treasurers, to be sure that everybody fills out their LM reports and so forth. So, your constitution governs. So, I only started out there because that's where they start out in this book. If I wrote a book on steward training or whatever, I would start with Article 15. I would have the new stewards read Article 15 so that you know the procedures, because if you don't follow the right procedures, it doesn't matter what kind of grievance you've got if you're procedurally defective. So I tell new stewards, sit down and read Article 15. That's the easiest one to read because you don't have to go all the way through it. Because you only have to go through where it gets past step two. Once it gets on to step three and all that kind of stuff, that's where Dennis and I come in. So you only have to read that portion where you talk about what you have to do in Article 15 to have a procedurally correct grievance. Second thing I tell them to do is to read Article 17. That's where your steward's rights are. So you got to know what you're doing, because if you know I've only got 14 days to do it, then you say, okay, I better run over here and see what I can do. So I start out saying read Article 15, then you read Article 17, then I say the third article you should read is Article 16, because that involves people's jobs, and that's what we have a lot of. And then the fourth thing I tell you to do is read your particular craft article, mostly 37 in here. And then after that, I say, you read the articles as they come up. You know, if somebody comes up and says, I didn't get overtime, all right, now I'll go read the Article 8 and deal with Article 8, learn Article 8. And if a holiday issue comes up, well, you can go to the contract where Article 11 deals with those particular items. So. All right. So in order to be procedurally correct, getting back to the book, all steward certification has to be in writing to the installation head. Does everybody know that? You'd be surprised how many places we have people operating as stewards that they don't even have anything saying that they're the steward. They just make themselves the steward. We have local unions that don't even have any elections. Somebody just says, "Who wants to be president?" Oh, hell, I'll take it. So, well, you'd be a steward. Yeah, I'll be the steward. But in order to be contractually correct, you have to have a written certification for the installation head designating your stewards, and it tells you how to do that in Article 17. We don't have time to go exactly into it. Now, once we get out into the MALs, where there are no locals and we need shop stewards, that's where Dennis and I's office certifies someone, state officer usually, to act as a steward for that particular office. So, how many people know that if you're the president, you're also the steward? No, you're not.
Chief Steward?
You're the president, you're the steward, only if you make yourself the steward on a letter to your installation. So you gotta be careful of that, because we have people out here operating as presidents who think they're stewards. Now what management does is they know you're doing it wrong, and they go along with it until you get a big money item. And then they call you out and say you're procedurally defective because you're not the steward. So, just want to be sure you do things correct. So, read the articles, follow the procedures, and be correct. That's what it says at the bottom of page 1 here. If challenged by management, improper certification of steward may render the grievance procedure defective. Therefore, you should consult with your president for written certification. I guarantee you, a lot of you remember casuals in lieu of and all the millions of dollars, all the fun we had, all the money we got, all the happiness and we did. Well, believe it or not, there was areas of the country where casual in lieu of came up and suddenly the case was proceeded effective because the local president filed it but wasn't a steward. They save those type of things for that, so don't be caught in that trap. If you're not doing it right, hey, if we've always worked on this good old boy system, stop it now and start giving them a certification. It can be on a piece of paper, it can be on a brown paper bag, it doesn't matter. As long as you give them something saying, I am the steward, or this person is the steward.
For those of you that have small offices in your local, like an area local, need to make sure that you certify whoever in that particular office in writing to the installation head. Because just because you have a different post office that's under your jurisdiction, per se, under your local agreement or area local, that doesn't automatically make you certified into that office. So, just because you're a steward in Little Rock doesn't mean you're the steward in Cabot or Russellville or wherever you're at. You need to individually do those.
On over to page 2. Here are the duties of shop steward. Tammy talked a little bit about this. I don't know what kind of documents they gave you as far as your week of school in Washington. But. Probably something similar to this. When I realize that you are the leader, that you are the person that everybody looks to because you're the shop steward, so you have to be the person. And so forth. That's right. And a lot of times, being the steward and talking to someone is simply a matter of talking to someone that's just pissed off about something they want somebody to listen to. So you have to be a good listener, and so forth. And what I tell people is, when you're a steward, always tell the people the truth. Don't lie to them. Tell them the truth, even though you don't want to. Because as I've always said, I was a steward once, and I know, working on the workroom floor. Kansas City, Missouri, we had probably 3,000 employees. That's a lot of pissed off people. But I found real quick that I would tell someone the truth, and they might cuss me out or say, well, I want to see John, or I want to see somebody else. And I say, well, go ahead and see him. I just told you the truth. If you want somebody else to tell you something not the truth, I can point out 5 or 6 people that will tell you what you want to hear. But I'm telling you the truth. So they go away and they cuss me. A few months later they come back and said, Bob Kessler was a hell of a great guy because he told me the truth. Now those people out there that he went to, and they say, oh, don't listen to him. That's bullshit. That's a good grievance. We'll fire that right on up step 2. We're going to get you your money or whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, 10 years later, they're waiting for their money. They're saying, well, that's not the best lie to them. So, tell them the truth up front. Take your cussing. They'll come back and thank you later on. Don't lie to them. Tell them the truth. They deserve to have the truth be known. And that's where it should be. All right. So all these duties of the shop steward is all well and good, but when you get right down to it, here's the duties of the shop steward. My words, you won't find them down here. Investigate, document, process grievances, making the correct arguments based on the facts of the case, including who, what, when, where, why. Sound familiar? Well, that's your duty. Because if you don't investigate, document, and process your grievance, make the correct arguments, and if you don't address the facts of the case, if you don't tell us who, if you don't tell us what, where, when, why, or how this violates the contract, you have Dennis and I sitting up here looking at your grievance, trying to figure out what the hell this is about.
Yeah.
It happens all the time. It's really a simple process. Writing a grievance is so simple. I don't know why some of you try to make it so hard. It's just a matter of putting down the facts. Just the facts. We don't need the dissertation about supervisor's a nasty bastard and don't like anybody. That doesn't get us anywhere.
Isn't that a given?
Yeah, it's true.
We have actual grievances where the steward and the step 2 designee trade insults in the written grievance. You know, the steward will say something, and then the step 2 answer comes back and says, well, if George would come to work, or if he would get a different girlfriend than Sally who's living with him and won't come to work the same day as he don't come to work, maybe he wouldn't get this destiny. Now, those are literal grievances that we've seen.
There's only one place that we allow that, and that's Columbia, Missouri, where we had the postmaster and another, one of their stewards, Marcotte, and postmaster was Huffmaster, and it's like me and Bob would fight over to get to read that grievance first, but rest of you don't do that. There was one and that was basically what it was jab for jab and back and forth, but we'd rather not have that.
It makes interesting reading.
But it's hard to figure out what it's about.
So anyway, that's in a nutshell what the duties of the steward is. Investigate, document, process grievances, making the correct arguments based on the facts of the case, such as who, what, when, where, why, and how can we remedy. Okay, violating the duty of fair representation on page 3. Probably most of you do not realize that we are a union because the employees elected us as their representative. That happened years and years and years and years and years and years ago. Actually, I participated in that election. I've been around that long. Certain unions. One time we had 10 or 20 unions representing a particular installation. Eventually they had elections, and in some areas the United Federation of Postal Workers won. Some other areas the National Postal Union won. In other areas the National Alliance won. So eventually they had one big election, and we all fought it out, and the whole installation, each installation was covered by one particular union. Well, then in 1971, all of those unions merged. And that's why we now have the American Postal Workers Union. We have one union representing clerks, maintenance, motor vehicle. So, some of you wonder, well, why don't we have the mail handlers? I've been around long enough to know why we don't have the mail handlers. When we had a president named Stuart Philby, who was our first president, he was offered the mail handlers, said that we will turn over the mail handlers to you for $1 million. And he said, we don't want no damn mail handlers.
Oh.
That, instead of paying $1 million for the right to represent the mail handlers, has probably cost us $1 billion fighting. Decisions that you make have consequences. To me, it's a no-brainer. They should have snatched it up when they had a chance. But anyway, I just throw a little historical tidbit in there for you so that you know. Why will the mail handlers never, ever merge with us? Because they don't have their own union. They joined the Laborers International Union, whatever, LIUNA. The Mail Handlers Union contributes millions of dollars into the treasury of LIUNA just by selling their health plan. The Mail Handlers will never merge with us because the LIUNA will not let them go. So, why won't the letter carriers merge with us? Because we don't have a damn thing in common.
Letters?
They don't work Sundays. They don't work holidays. They're not fighting on overtime. They don't care about holiday scheduling, holiday premium. They don't care about penalty time and overtime. They don't care about supervisor form of bargaining or work. We have nothing in common. We were together in the beginning. And it was good that we were bargaining together. But at some point in time in the bargaining together, they stabbed us in the back a couple of times on Article 8. I come to overtime as Ireland. You say they don't care about overtime like our people do. Other than discipline, overtime is our biggest business. You either love it and will kill for it, or you hate it and you'll kill somebody for it. Either way, kill for it, keep her mad. But anyway, all right, I'm getting off the side. Violating the duty of fair representation. So as a result of electing and having the right to be the exclusive representative of the postal workers in our office, we have the duty to fairly represent them. We can't just take their money and say, don't bother me, I don't have time for your little petty grievance.
Mm-hmm.
You have to fairly represent them and you have the exclusive right. So, if we're vested with the responsibility to represent them because we have their right to represent them. So, we have to represent both members and non-members to the best of our ability. The first thing that a non-member will do, if they don't get what they want, will go to the labor board and charge you with not fairly representing them because they're a non-member. So,
turn off?
You can do it. Okay. I don't care what I say. Don't care who
just
hears.
Tell me when.
I don't care who hears. Nothing says that a steward is always going to do the very best they can in every particular situation. All you have to do is to do your best. And if some days you fail, you just fail. As long as you don't write down the reason you failed is, I don't like this song, kid.
I know what that feels like.
You can fairly represent people, and you can unfairly represent people, and nobody will know the difference as long as you have a reason for what you do. Whether it's the correct reason or not. So, I'm not saying don't represent non-members. I'm just saying don't not represent non-members and say I didn't represent that non-member, but they're a non-member. That is a violation of the duty of fair representation that gets you in big trouble. So, duty of fair representation comes down into certain words. Arbitrary. There's an example. When asked why the grievance was not appealed, the shop steward may state that he or she did not think it was a violation. If questioned by the National Labor Relations Board, the steward must be able to prove that he or she has not appealed similar cases of this nature. Now that sounds a little bit scary. That's like, well, I didn't think it was a violation. You have the right not to pursue something if you don't think it's a violation. But if you get called on it, you have to say why you didn't think it's a violation. You can't say, well, just because I didn't. So you need to have a little bit of a reason for thinking it's not a violation. Don't staple them together all in a nice, neat little wad. Why?
You can't copy them.
You'll piss Debbie off.
Because she scans them into the computer.
You're going to stick it in the copier and it's going to jam up and ball them all up. Mm-hmm.
That's right.
Then I'm going to be cussing.
That's right.
Well, Debbie is.
Listen, I'm afraid that Debbie's picked up some bad habits from us. We do so much cussing, I believe she's getting close to the point where she's outdoing us. When your grievances come to our office, it's not Dennis and I opening these things up and saying, all right, let me read this grievance. It's Debbie or Taylor opening this thing up, and the first thing they do is they make a grievance file, and when they make the grievance file, they have to scan it through the scanner, which is like the copy machine. When you get a grievance that has 135 staples in there that have to each be taken apart by the office assistant before they can scan, you get about 135 bad words coming out. And we know what's going on. Oh, Debbie's scanning grievances. There's another reason for it.
Use binder clips.
When you tear off staples with two pieces of paper, most of the time you have to recopy those toe pieces because you tore the hell out of them. It's hard to undo a staple with two pieces of paper. Some of you send grievance packages this thick and you staple that sucker too. We have staple pullers, and then we have a huge staple puller. Sometimes it takes 15 minutes to take one of those things apart, try and get that big ass staple out. And then when we do, half the pages are tore up, or they're all mashed together to where you can't even get them apart. You got to separate page by page, because if you run it through the scanner, it sucks in five pages, and then you get five more cuss words. Don't staple that stuff. Put a rubber band around it.
But binder clips. Binder clips.
Put a binder on it that they can take off and slide that through there, and they'll love you to death.
How about paper clip?
Because it's, paper clip. You know, it's just a heck of a lot of work, and we need for you not to use staples. We need for you to use the correct form
so
where
thick.
You can.
You have to have a binder clip.
We need for you to do a good job of telling us the facts of the case. In your step two, when you write them up, give us the facts, who, what, when, why, and where, so that when we read it, we can tell what it is. If you have clock rings that you have to send us, put a sheet on there telling us what these clock rings are, what they prove. Highlight that little portion that you're wanting to do. Don't just send us clock rings. I'll tell this final story that came up the other day. I love March Madness basketball. On a Sunday, I'm in the office, March Madness is going on, and I have a stock of clock rings about this big, no summary, no highlight, no explanation, and I'm trying to prepare for meetings on Monday so that I can explain to somebody what this is. And Jeff Beaton, the maintenance guy, happened to come in that day, and he said, "What the hell are you doing in here?" I said, "It's March Madness." I said, "I'm trying to figure this out." And it suddenly occurred to me, you know what? I know the steward that sent me this. That son of a bitch is home watching March Madness right now. And I'm in here trying to figure out his frickin' clock rings. And I threw that sucker on the table and I went home and watched basketball. Don't send us stuff and tell us to figure it out. Here's some shit, figure it out. Okay, I'm sorry for all my language. At least I kept you awake. So, it's
great.
My pleasure. We're through with this portion of my national business agents. Based on talking with my national business agents, I came to the conclusion that there was no merit to this agreement. Now you're not being arbitrary. You have a reason. You made an effort. You decided it shouldn't be something that was pursued. Capricious. The shop steward has a reason why he or she did not appeal the grievance, but the reason's not logical. Example. Shop steward refused to appeal some cases addressing bargain unit work because he or she is tired of doing the same type of grievance all the time. Or, the one that you have to be careful of, or you filed before and you didn't win a step three, so why figure waste my time? Now, you can say you didn't pursue something because I pursued this issue before and obtained an unfavorable result, and this one was the same as that one, in my opinion. That's okay. That's not being capricious. You have a reason, and the reason makes sense. Perfunctory. The shop steward does not conduct a proper investigation before closing the case and puts little or no effort determining the facts. That's what we call going through the motions. We have some people that go through the motions. Bad faith. Shop steward allows personal feelings, union politics, or bias to interfere with the representation of employees. The two examples, the NUMS, which I call a non-union member, I just call them NUMS.
No scabs, huh?
Some people you just don't like. That's bad faith. And that's true. Some people, you just don't like it. Just still, that's not a reason not to represent them or do your best or at least show your best. Or at least be able to give a reason why you didn't do your best on that. And here's an example. A national arbitration advocate withdraws a removal case prior to going to arbitration. It's later discovered that the grievance had dated the advocate's spouse or significant other. Those type of things get you in big, big trouble. Now, when you have the duty of fair representation, there might be a violation of the duty of fair representation.
So forth
and so on. And of course, the supervisor said that the employee attacked him and he was just defending himself, so he had to talk and attack the employee back. And so we got the supervisor and we got an employee, we're down in the basement, and they both come up with blood on their face. So what do you think happened? Well, they didn't fire the damn supervisor, that's for sure.
No.
Well, they fired this guy. Okay. So. This happened back in the early days when all grievances went to Washington. Like right now, you get a grievance involving this one, it comes to Dennis or I. You go step one, you go step two, and then you do direct appeal to arbitration, not step three. Direct step two, direct appeal to arbitration, and it comes to Dennis, and we either pursue it or through arbitration, or we tell the local we're not going to pursue it in law. But back in the 70s, before we had regional arbitration, everything went to headquarters. That's why when you look at your step four decisions, you go in and you get the whole step four decisions and you look, they're all dated back in the 70s, or maybe the early 80s. That's because every grievance that was filed went to headquarters and they became step fours, and that's how you interpret your contract, by the parties at step four. We've reached a stage now where I don't know if I've sent a case to step four. So we have very few step four. Most step fours now are raised with our headquarters people. They will initiate step four briefs. We very seldom have a step four that arises coming from out of the field through the grievance procedure and having the business agent shipping on that. I'll go ahead and tell you a story anyway. Since there are no casuals, I have no fun with casuals anymore. I just have to rent a desk and I told guys that we just went ahead. But anyway, we had Des Moines, Iowa, which happened to be one of our areas. They kill for overtime. Everything was theirs. They wanted overtime. So had these casuals, and so they assigned casuals for 3 days to help with some work. For 3 days. So they filed his grievance and sent it up to us. At the time, I had a part-time officer who was also from Des Moines. And the local talked him into sending it up to step four. I said, don't send that up to step four. Because I don't believe that it's correct. If you send that up to step four and you lose that, then you're going to be in some big trouble. Well, anyway, he didn't heed my advice, and I wasn't really his boss. So he shipped it up to step four, and they eventually ended up arbitrating it. And they got an arbitration decision by a guy named Zumas. And Zumas basically said, the only restrictions you have on the use of casuals is their 90-day limits and their appointments. And the post office then took that national award and they just raped us with casuals all over this country for about 10 years until we started out in the field again. Started coming up and saying, Zumas doesn't apply, because that was just for a temporary 3-day thing. We're talking about hired in lieu of. We have all these other restrictions. You can't hire them in lieu of. That was a utilization case. So, anyway, that's just another story that you can have. So let me get back to Bowen. So what happened with Bowen is, as the national officer in Washington is reviewing a stack of cases this high, because he's got the discipline from all over the country, okay? So he goes in the room, and this is how he does his review. He picks them over, he looks at them, says, arbitrate, no arbitrate, arbitrate, no arbitrate. He gets to Bowen. Oh, hell, we never went in. Well, Bowen went to court and sued us for not pursuing his case. And so when the NLRB came and talked to our national officer, started asking questions, what's your process for reviewing these cases? He says, well, I have all the discipline in the country. And I have a day, and I come in here, and I look them over, and I look at the case, and I say, arbitrate. And I say, don't arbitrate. Arbitrate, don't arbitrate. Some of these things have been sitting there for 3 or 4 years waiting for an arbitration. So, to make a long story short, because he really couldn't explain how, when this case was certified for arbitration, went all the way up the procedure, everybody thought it was merited pursuing, and got to him, he spent about 5 minutes deciding that it wasn't worth anything. So, we lost and got sued, quite heavily. As a result of that, we have a 6-month statute of limitation. So, as a result of that, you should keep your records. When you do your grievances, you should fill out that step one worksheet. And if you're not going to pursue that step one to step two, you should write on there. Chose not to fill this step two because I don't believe there's any merit. Keep a record of it and date it. Okay? And then the same thing with your step twos. If you have a step two and you're not going to pursue it to step three, you should write on that. I discussed this, did investigation, did research, couldn't find anything to support this, so I decided not to appeal it to the next step. And then you date it. That way, nobody can come back on you beyond 6 months. That's why when we get a notice of removal that we don't pursue. We mail a certified letter and we mail a regular letter out to the gray law to notify them that we're not going to pursue your case. Why do we do that?
Six months.
And out there to get their signature on there so that that we can prove that they were notified. Why do we send regular mail too? Because 99 times out of 100, they won't pick it up. They know what it is, and they don't want to pick it up. But the one we send regular mail never comes back. So what we do is when they come back, refuse, didn't pick up, or whatever, we just put it right in our grievance file, and we hang on to it for 5 years. So that's why we do it. Declare in unquestionable terms of collective bargaining agreement and the right to have his or her grievance decide on his own merit. That's basically what an employee has as a right. The right of the union. The right of the union is not to process non-meritorious grievances. It says right in our contract that we have the authority to pursue or to withdraw any grievance. So not only do we have a contractual right to do it, it's right there where it says we have a contractual right. We just don't have the right to be arbitrary, capricious, or perfunctory, or act in bad faith when we do not pursue it. So, keep those records. You do not have to process grievances that do not have merit. Shop steward's rights. Did you guys cover any shop steward's rights when you were in Washington? Oh, yeah. We could spend 2 days on shop steward's rights alone. So, we don't have 2 days. But if you look and read, line by line, what your rights are, Article 17, you will see that you have some powerful rights. The right to investigate unjust grievances or to investigate a specific problem, determine whether to file a grievance. The right to review documents, files, other records which are necessary for processing the grievance or determine if the grievance exists. The right to interview the aggrieved employees, supervisors, witnesses, anybody that you want to. The right to represent employees when OIG get a hold of them. This is the right right that you usually don't want. The right to reasonably time on the clock, to complete grievance forms, or to write all appeals, including step-3 appeals, and to write the additions and corrections. You have the right to process post-removal grievances, provided the grievance is non-disciplinary and not related to the removal action. In other words, even after people resign, quit, get fired, if we have a grievance that's in the system, that's meritorious, we can still pursue that grievance. Stewards have super seniority. So, these are some powerful rights. You need to be careful with that super seniority because we have such situations where people take a storage job when they know excess is coming up. So you want to be careful with that because we've had some big battles. I have about a 45-minute story I won't tell you today because we don't have time. Got to be really careful with super seniority and letting someone take over the union just before excesses have started coming up. When you take over the union, then you decide who the steward is, and suddenly you decide I'm the steward. I'm the junior employee, and you're not done. Tips for the steward. I won't go into those. You can read them for yourself, but as I said, always tell them the truth. Don't let men set your time limits. Don't speak against the union. Put us down in front of the members. Don't hold back information relative to processing the grievance. We used to actually teach people that way back in the beginning. We don't give them everything. Save a little bit back and we'll zing them in the end. That doesn't work anymore. You have to give them everything. Never tell somebody that their case is a sure win. Never, never, ever tell them that we're going to win this case. Tell them we really believe we're going to win this. We've got a great case. Whatever, but don't guarantee we're going to win. Okay, working knowledge. Collective bargaining agreement, JSIM, regional joint contract administration manual, LMOUs, all the post service handbooks and manuals. Stretch from this side of the room over to that side of the room. Don't let that frighten you, because you don't have to sit there and know everything in there. I don't know everything in there. Dennis don't know everything in there. And we have to go in there and look them up, research them just like you do. All you worry about is just take things one at a time and do the best you can. The steward should utilize the forms for when they get steward released. Why is that important?
Consistency in the fire.
It's because you have immunity, and you are their equal when you're operating in the capacity of a steward. And you can even raise your voice and all that kind of stuff. You can argue. You can even use a little bit of profanity as long as you do it off the workroom floor, in private. And that's why you should have all of your official discussions off the workroom floor, in private. Because you are their equal, you stand up to them, you don't have to listen to no bullshit to them. Young lady back there, you don't have to let that manager get on you out there on the floor. You just say, I'm going to file a grievance. And you go back and you file a grievance against being talked to like that. They don't have the right to talk to you as a union steward out there in front of your peers. Like that. That's an unfair labor practice. All right. How long are we going to be for lunch?
Just carry.
12 to 1:30.
I'll stay for one more minute then. Your immunity here is on page 9. The immunity takes effect when you're officially on your 70-20, officially working on a grievance. So don't think just because you're wearing this badge around on the floor that you have immunity and you can go off on it. You can't. But like I said, you can get up in the supervisor's face, and you can shake their finger in their face just like they're shaking their finger in your face, as long as it's not out in front of the people. It has to be off the fryer. Okay. know, page 9 and 10, some examples of things you can't do, like counsel employees, refuse to answer questions, and so forth and so on. You can't disrupt the work workforce, and so forth. And then the tips for the steward on page 11, have that meeting in private so that you can get in their face, and raise your voice, keep your cool. Don't take it out on the workroom floor, because that's where we've had problems with people taking it out on the workroom floor. So, I think I'll stop there. We'll come back. And it's identified in the collective bargaining agreement, Article 15, actually. A grievance is defined as a dispute, difference, disagreement, or complaint between the parties related to wages, hours, and conditions of employment. A grievance shall include, but is not limited to, the complaint of an employee or of the union, which involves the interpretation, application of, or compliance with the provisions of this agreement or any local memorandum of understanding not in conflict with this agreement. So therefore, you can say just about anything can be a grievance. And that's why we have such a backlog of grievances.
Yeah.
Nationwide, because our people grieve everything. You know, out there in the baseball industry, for those of you who are baseball fans, if somebody files a grievance within 3 weeks, they've had an arbitration hearing. We file a grievance within 3 weeks, we can't even get a step one decision. So that's one of the reasons why, is because not only do we have all these rights, but we have this broad generalization of what constitutes a grievance, so we can grieve just about anything, and we do grieve anything. Last time I taught this class, I told the story about filing a grievance on the color of the toilet paper in a men's room. Wow. We actually had a grievance like that in one office.
You're kidding.
Nope, not kidding. It's true. They even grieved the color of the toilet paper. So. It's up to us to take the frivolous grievances and write down there on the step one, okay, this person insists that I file to try to get this from government white to pretty blue. but I didn't figure I could do that in arbitration, so I'm not going to proceed. So anyway. Okay, class action grievances. We have class actions and we have individuals. For some reason, we have some locals that put class action on everything. Maybe it's just easier that way. I've seen a removal for Joe Jones, and it says class action. I thought Joe Jones was the person. So anyway, class action simply means if you have a grievance that involves more than one person, you just put class action. But if you have a person, don't put class action. We see grievances that come up to say class action, and it's for Joe Jones because he missed overtime. That's not class action. That's Joe Jones' grievance. So, you can file class actions. You can file individual grievances. The contract in Article 15 tells you how to go about doing that, tells you who you file with, and so forth. But I would point out to you that the contract also says on certain types of grievances where class actions are involved, management designates who you meet with. So be careful with that. Be sure that you meet with someone that's been designated. We used to have the casualty in lieu of, which is clearly a class action deal, which we don't have anymore because we don't have casuals. But we have things like act of God. If you have an act of God, you should file a class action. You should have somebody designated to file a class action on behalf of everyone in the installation for this storm. And then you should meet with that designated official at step one. But that's not the way it happens. We don't get very many acts of God down in Arkansas, but in Missouri, my home local, seems like we have at least one act of God every year when the storms hit. And my local has each one of the stewards for each tour file a class action for their tour, for the Clark craft. Each one of their stewards file a grievance for the maintenance craft for their tour. Each one files for motor vehicle. Somebody else files for the stations. And then I get this hodgepodge of grievances. And I would pull my hair out, except my hair is already gone. Why the hell can't you just file one grievance for one storm, for one installation? Because everything that involves everybody is in every one of those grievances. So I end up finally getting one and addressing it. And then we have to go and apply this grievance to the outcome of that grievance, to the outcome of this grievance, and so forth. So class action is simply a grievance that involves more than one person, so that you don't have to write a bunch of names up there. I have found it interesting on page 13, number 5, it says that the union cannot ask for a class action remedy if the grievance is filed under only one employee's name. So, that makes sense, I guess.
Yeah, and we get stuff thrown out because of that. You know, sometimes our step 3 rep will say, I can't pay that. You know, but of course, Brimley is the grievant, but it covers everybody else, and they won't want to pay anybody.
Exactly. Okay, and so then it gives you a special note, which is a remedy that you should avoid. Pay the appropriate employees at the appropriate rate for the appropriate amount of hours, too. Listing the affected employees and identifying his or her entitlements individually along with his or her EIN assures quick payment under the grievance arbitration tracking system, or GATS. We just call it GATS. Now, while this book tells you to avoid this remedy, the fact is we ourselves have taught you to use that remedy at times to start with, because there are some times you file a grievance, you don't know who the appropriate employee is, you don't know the appropriate rate, and you don't know the appropriate hours at the time. So while this national book tells you avoid that remedy, we're telling you that in the beginning, there's nothing wrong with that remedy, but by the time you file it, step 1, by the time you gather all your information and you get all the information from management, and by the time you write that grievance up to step 2, discuss that at step 2, by step 2 you should be able to identify who's involved. You should be able to know the amount of hours in violation. And you should be able to identify the names of the people that were involved that are entitled to part of the remedy. And it is true, one thing that you need to do in your grievances is you need to try to identify who you want paid and their EIN number and put it in the grievance package to us. If nothing else, if you can't get it anywhere else, put it in your summary. Say this grievance seeks payment of $52.16 to Susan, EIN number whatever, for missing an hour of penalty overtime. That way it's not so hard for us to figure out. Also at step 3 now, in the last few years, the post office has began paying grievances at step 3. The people that we discuss with, if we settle a grievance, they actually make the payment into the GATS system when they discuss the grievance with us, if they have a name and if they have an EIN. So you can help yourself by identifying who you want paid and their EIN number, and you can help us by identifying how much time is involved, and you can help us by going ahead and doing the math and telling us what that person makes per hour, which would constitute an hour of penalty pay. Otherwise, here's what you're going to get from us. We handle hundreds of grievances. We don't have time to whip out our little pay scale, look down here at the grievance and say, pay level, oh hell, they left that blank. I guess I'm supposed to guess. Well, let me say, they've been around there ever since I've been around there, so they probably should be top scale. Let me see what top scale is. We don't have time to figure that out for you is what I'm trying to say. You have that time. You're on the clock. You know who's involved. You just wrote the grievance up. Give us the name of the people, the amount of money they're entitled to per remedy. Because otherwise, we're going to guess. And like right now, I can't speak for Dennis, but I'm a lazy guy. Like right now, if I'm discussing a grievance and you don't tell me, pay somebody $26.18 or $27.30, if I get a grievance of miles an hour, they're going to get $26. You know why that is? Because that's easy to figure out in my head. $26 an hour, $52 for overtime, $39 penalty, $39 for overtime. So if you get a grievance settled back, and you say pay somebody $39 for missing an hour of overtime, and you start wanting to cuss me, don't cuss me. Cuss you, because you should have told me it's not $39. It's $42 and a nickel, or whatever the heck it might be, because I'm not going to sit down here and try to figure that out. I ain't got no Ouija board. So, again, you start at step one. It takes them at least a week to battle with them to get a meeting. And then it takes you a week to get a decision, sometimes two or three. Then it takes you a while to peel it up step two. Then it takes you forever for them to meet with you at step two and give you a decision for step two. In the meantime, you started this grievance. Well, once you start the grievance, that's only the start. That's not the end. So once you started the grievance, go ahead and finish your investigation. Go ahead and find out and go ahead and figure out who in the heck is involved and how many people are involved and the names of the people you want paid and get their EIN numbers. There's just no excuse for filing a grievance at step one in January and in March send it up to us and say, here's this grievance, you figure it out for us. Okay? You should have it figured out. You should tell us who it is. You should give us their numbers. You should calculate their salary figure of what they're entitled to. Everybody understand what I'm saying? Okay. You help us, we help you. You do a better job, we do a better job. Instead of getting your grievance for $26, you get a real hourly wage of $27.12 or something, somebody might. I've had people call and say, how come I only got $39? And I have to say, well, how come your steward didn't tell me what level, what step you are? You know, I can't figure it out. I don't know it. I don't know. How many people we got now? Like 6,000? Don't know the salary rate of all 6,000 of them. I don't even know how much I make. Okay, I'm preaching, but preaching for a reason. Trying to help you do a better job so we can do a better job. Page 14, tools for shop stewards. You got them all checked down there. You can pretty much see what they are. Main thing you need is you need the elm probably more than anything. You should be familiar with that EL 921, Supervisor's Guide to Handling. You need that for discipline cases. If you don't have a copy, get a copy. Can't find a copy, tell us. We'll get 37 questions and answers. That's in the contract, I believe. So if you got Article 37, you got a contract, you've got those. Anytime you're dealing with any of these subjects, like overtime desire lists, holiday schedules, and whatever, depends on whether or not you're processing the grievance that involves that article and whether or not you need that. Okay, proper documentation of grievances. In order for the union to prevail in arbitration, it's important to include the proper documentation in the grievance file. List below are various contract violations and the documentation which must be included in filing these types of grievances. Don't just say it, prove it with documents or statements, but remember the golden rule. A document supports an argument, it does not make an argument. Argument is not evidence. Okay? Now, what follows in this book are various issues, have been formulated over the years by various meetings with all the business agents. And some of it was not just business agents. Some of it started out like an individual business agent put a book out. Lyle Creek put out a book. And they had a lot of this. Like, all right, what documents do I need? Lyle was good at having documents and stuff like that.
This morning about us being available Monday through Friday evenings, mornings, Saturdays, Sundays, there is an exception to that rule. That's when the Chiefs and the Royals are playing, when KU's playing or the Razorbacks are playing. We probably won't get in touch with it at that time. We'll probably ignore your phone call and then call you back at halftime or whenever we can get a chance. So we do kind of a card rule. When those things come up, we do kind of, of course, they're mostly in the evening or on the Saturdays, but yeah, we're around there. You know how to get in touch with us. Got cell phones, know how to get in touch with us. And if we can't call you at that, right, that don't answer your call, we'll call you back as soon. And just one of, Bob said a few things about me. I just want to talk a couple things about him. You know, he talked about he didn't really want to be a steward, didn't want to be a president. I remember, this is many, many years ago, I don't even think I was a steward, but we went to Tri-State Convention in the Renaissance Mulebach. Is that it? Probably there, maybe Carrie or only a couple can remember back that when we went there. But I still remember we went to the hospitality room. Went in the hospitality room, we were just having a drink or two, and looked over there, and I don't even think I knew Bob. Might have maybe known him from the meeting there. And he's over and had a restroom in the hospitality room. Bob's over there picking up crap and toilet papers and papers and everything down there. And, you know, goddamn, who did this? And at the same time, there was this gal over there. What you do with my goddamn grievance? How can you do it like that? And I thought, God, who would want a job like that? But still remember that. But, you know, me and Bob enjoy, you know, working together. It's good. He's a friend more than a co-worker, and we let each other cuss at each other or cuss at somebody, and secretary follows along with it, so, you know, that we kind of bend off each other when we get a chance. Before going into some of these scenarios in the book, most of them are what we're going to talk about is getting the documentation, and there's numerous scenarios in here, but before that, just, I'm not really going to go over this particular one, but I do want to bring your attention to one in particular that has to do with 39, okay, there it is. Really won't go over this, but the significance of this is for those that are stewards and new stewards, this is about being denied steward time. But what I want to bring your attention is on pages, the bottom of 39, 40, and 41. Those are your rights as a steward. It says tips of a steward, but those are your rights. You have the right to investigate, adjust, right have to review documents, do it on the clock, meet with the OIG, so on and so forth. So we won't go into all those, but that's something good for any steward degree, especially the new ones. One more before we go to those different scenarios. Back to page 14, Bob. It had gone over that about the tools for shop stewards. I just want to make a couple of notes on this, where it says a local memorandum of understanding. If you have a grievance that involves your LMOU, please include it. Okay? We don't memorize everybody's LMOU in here. I have enough trouble remembering what I had in my own local. So make sure if you have something that addresses, it's an issue over your LMOU, you put that. If not, at least put the right page in there. Also, on that note, for those of you, if we ever have LMOU training again, your LMOU changes, send a copy to our local, to our office. We keep a copy of not only the new ones, but the old ones, and we have a file that we put all of them in there. So I think most of you have a copy of the LMOU, but if something changes, if we ever have it, make sure we get an update on it. Overtime desired list. If you have an overtime, agreements on overtime desired list, put it in there, but please send us one that's readable. I had a case the other day, and this was out of Missouri, and a gal said, okay, I'll pay the people on the overtime desired list. Well, didn't have a copy of the overtime desired list. So I get a copy of the overtime desired list for tier three, and you know what it said on there? Susie, Bob, Carl, John. Had no idea, so I'm sitting there with 30 people trying to figure out, okay, is this John Taff? Is this John Hinton? Who in the hell it is? So if you have an overtime desire list, send it up, you know, and if they just sign it John, when you send it up, put their last name by there so we can identify who to pay. That's one of my pet peeves. We get that. I get that all the time. Pay the overtime desire list, and we don't have one. And one other thing, job postings. If we have a case that involves a job, a split day off, Article 37, give us a job, a copy of it in there. So we can see, you know, when it was posted, how long it was posted, is it old, is it new, is it changed, whatever. So make sure if you say the post office failed to post job number 70432, we got a copy. Okay?
Go
ahead.
Going back to what I just said, when he mentions the overtime desire list, pay the overtime desire list. By the time that gets to us, even though the grievance says pay the overtime desire list, you should have a summary in there that says this is the overtime desire list, and these are the people we want paid, and this is how much they make.
If we have that information at step three, we would get it paid right then. Otherwise, we have two options. We wait on you to send it to us, or we have to send it back, and then you have to send me the names, and then I have to send Michelle or whoever the name is. It just takes forever. So if you've got it in there, ID numbers, you need to have the ID numbers of the people, their name and who to pay, how much. And a lot of times, you know, they want their ID number. I send it in with it. They can put it in the computer 5 minutes after.
County farm workers request that violation of terms of this grievance or failure to observe safety rules and regulations. So, anytime you start your grievance and tell the story, you always say the grievant received a notice of removal dated whatever, whatever, for just cause. Such discipline was not issued for just cause, or in violation of Article 16 in that it was not for just cause, and or that it was not corrective in nature. That's basically what you're saying. And you fill in all the blocks and blanks that go down behind it. Notice the terms. Insubordination, pilferage, intoxication, failure to perform work as requested, violation of safety and rules and regulations. These are just examples. Anything that's misconduct can be a subject of discipline. Whether or not it constitutes a justification for discipline depends on the facts and circumstances. You can be guilty of insubordination without intending to be. You can be guilty of failure to follow instruction without intending to be. So, if I'm given an instruction to get that truck out on the dock before you leave, then I'm supposed to do that. But something may come up that I may not get that done. It won't be because I willfully said, by God, I'm not putting that truck out on the dock before I leave. It might be that two or three people went home sick. Somebody else come told me, you got to get this out, you got to get that done. And in the hubbub and the rush and whatever, and I'm the only one there by myself, I completely forgot about getting that truck out there. So that means what? Yes, I'm guilty of not doing it, but should I be disciplined for that? There's a difference between willful misconduct and unintentional violation of something. So, you have extenuating circumstances, you have mitigating circumstances. An extenuating circumstance, or a mitigating circumstance, is what you argue when you say there's no just cause. Mitigation is something that says this person is guilty as charged, but there's a reason why the discipline shouldn't be so heavy. That falls in with corrective versus punitive. So if I do something that's not willful, that's a mitigating factor, lessens the penalty. Doesn't make me not guilty, but maybe don't get me fired, maybe just gets me a letter of warning or whatever. You have extenuating circumstances. Extenuating circumstances, yes, I'm guilty, but you can't discipline me anyway. Because, let's say someone was told to report to work for a day off, and on the way to work, ambulance runs over. They end up in the hospital. They can't fire you because you didn't come to work, failed to follow instruction. There's an extenuating circumstance here. I almost died, so you can't discipline me on top of that. I'm guilty of not coming to work, but there's an extenuating circumstance. So even though I'm guilty, you can't discipline me because Article 16 says you can't punish me. You got to correct me. There's no correction here. I didn't run over myself. No correction possible. So those are the type of things that you do in Article 16. We have a whole program on just discipline alone that would take a whole day. So obviously I just wanted to touch on some of those things. Notice of charges. And you address the notice of charges. If you're charged with theft, you address theft. If you're charged with failure to perform a certain duty, then that's what you defend against. Nothing else. You defend against the notice of charges. You're either not guilty of the notice of charge, or yes, I'm guilty, but there's a mitigating factor. One of the mitigating factors is the number of years that you've been employed. One of the biggest mitigations that we have in removals is that this is a 30-year employee, this is a 25-year employee, or this is a 50-some-year employee, or this is a 10-year employee, or something. That's a mitigating factor that arbitrators take into effect. And the other thing is misconduct. Can be misconduct, but if there is not a willful misconduct, that is a mitigating factor also. All right? Or suspension. The very first thing you ask for is what? Well, you'll get that, because what will happen is the employee will get that and come to you and say, look, I got this. What's the first thing you're going to do?
Well, if it's a blue, you're going to ask for the inspector, man, whatever that is.
Got close back there. To save time, I'll help you. It's right here on page 42. If you'll be looking at it, then you should know. A copy of the supervisor's request for discipline or just cause package. You'll want to know why that supervisor took that particular action, because a lot of times they'll put right on there, I'm recommending that Bob be given a letter of warning because this is the fourth time he's been absent in the last 3 months, and I think his attendance is bad, and we need to do something about it. The next thing I know, here comes a notice of removal for Bob. Supervisor recommended a letter of warning. So look for the disciplinary action proposal, because that's the person that took the action. If they're asking for a suspension, they shouldn't be handed down a removal, because that's top-down discipline and so forth. So don't have time to go into it, but that's what you want to do, is you want to lock in the reason that the supervisor is asking for discipline or proposing the discipline. And then, of course, the second thing you want to do, especially if it's attendance cases, you want to interview that supervisor. Yes.
That packet you're talking about, is that the confirmation from a higher up to issue that discipline?
Yes.
Is that what you're, okay.
Some of it, a lot of times it's on that form.
Okay.
Usually on the second page. It's not always, but I know what you're talking. It's usually on the second page of that. Request for disciplinary action, a lot of it. And on the back, second page, it'll say,
concurring official.
Yeah, the concurring official.
Send it to labor, but they don't have.
A lot of times we get those that are never signed.
And you should ask for the reviewing concurring official, because a lot of times it won't be on there. And then Thursday, you guys have just went to Washington. No, we've got a whole program. We could spend a whole day on just procedurally defects and issuing discipline and all that kind of stuff that we just don't have time to go into today. Also in Article 16, it also says no one can be disciplined unless it's first been reviewed in and concurred by higher level authority. That reviewed in and concurred means somebody actually getting the proposal, looking at everything that the supervisor put together as a reason why, going through there and say, yeah, based on what I see, is I concur. It does not mean that supervisor runs up to you and say, here, sign this. I got to go fire this guy.
Yeah.
Oh. That happens all the time.
Yeah.
Or a supervisor it's just procedural stuff. Like
that's right.
Well, one other thing on that where it says documentation needed. The second one, it says any prior discipline issued to the grievant that was cited as past elements in the discipline letter. If you get a letter and a notice of removal and it says past elements of 14-day, 7-day, this day, this thing, we want copies of that, okay, with the file so we can look to see if it's even the same issue or whatever. So when you get a notice of removal, if they have prior discipline, they'll list it in that letter. And if it says a 7-day issue, July 4th, or whatever, ask for copies of that and put it in the file with it.
And then another crucial thing on your investigation in any discipline case is that management is required to conduct a fair and impartial investigation prior to. Fair and impartial investigation means looking at bad stuff that you did. It also means looking at the good stuff, like, oh, you got 30 years of service. That's what a fair and impartial investigation. We don't get fair and impartial investigation from the post office. We just get investigations designed to get you. Same thing with the postal inspection when they come in. I'll talk about that in a minute. Before I leave, page 43, a couple things I want to point out to you that crops up once in a while, but don't want to let it crop up for any of you. That's item number one. Grievance must be filed on the proposed removal letter. Anytime you get a letter that says it's proposed removal from the post office, that starts your time clock. And then item number two, once a grievance is on the notice of proposed removal is filed, it's not necessary to also file a grievance when they get a letter decision. Everybody understand? Okay. A lot of things in the post office, we don't have to grieve a reposting of jobs. They can tell us 6 months ahead of time we're going to repost your jobs. I don't have to file a grievance then. When they get around to actually reposting it or giving me something in writing saying I'm going to repost these tomorrow, that's when our time limits start. But on discipline, removals, the proposed notice of removal must be acted upon. All right. Tells you that if an employee requests the steward to be present, it shall be granted, and all polygraph tests will continue to be on a voluntary basis. I just want to just have time to cover a couple of things. Number one, you never take a polygraph test. And the reason is, and I've told this story before when we've done cases, years ago, CBS put on, 60 Minutes CBS, put on a deal where they had a dummy company contact four different companies that give polygraph tests, and to each one of them, they would then suggest who they thought their thief was of their four employees. So they went to Company A and said, we want this investigation to help you out, conduct polygraph, find out who's stealing from our company. We think it's Dennis Taff, but we want to be sure. And so give us your polygraph. So they give Dennis the polygraph and come back, and sure enough, it indicates Dennis Taff is your thief. So they went to Company B and said, well, we think it's Bob Kessler. Give us your whatever, you give the polygraph, come back, and sure enough, it's Bob Kessler was a thief. Same thing for employee three and employee four. Whichever one you suggested, that's who they came back and said, you're guilty. When you take a polygraph test with the Postal Service, given by the Postal Inspection itself, I don't give a shit what you say. They're going to say you're lying. You understand? Because whoever reads it determines what it says. And postal inspectors only looking for one thing. Guilty. Evidence to find you guilty of something. They're not looking for anything in your favor. They're not looking to exonerate you or whatever. So when it comes to polygraph tests, just say no. Okay? An employee must ask for a steward. A lot of times they'll ask for it, and the postal inspector will tell them, you don't need one. And then they'll go ahead and coerce them and talk to them into actually going ahead and talking and spilling their guts. And then at some point in time, after they spill their guts, say, well, maybe you do need a steward. You know? We need to get word out to people. Don't talk to them bastards unless you have to talk to a steward. You don't have to. They're not going to beat you with a rubber hose.
If you ask for a steward, do they automatically have to shut off the investigation?
Supposed to, yes, absolutely. But they won't do it. But they'll keep on, they got good cop, bad cop. And while one of them's saying, yeah, okay, I'll go see if I can find them, the other one's like pumping you for information. So just tell people, don't talk to them at all. Ask for a steward. Do not sign PS 1067 warning and waiver of your rights, ever. Just don't sign it. You don't have to sign it. Just tell them don't sign it. You are required to cooperate in an investigation by the Postal Inspection Service. Cooperation does not mean confess. Cooperation just means I'll give you my statement. I have not now, or ever in the past, knowingly done anything wrong which would violate any rules or regulations of the Postal Service. Robert D. Kessler, September the 10th, 2014. That's my cooperation. Oh, but that's not good enough. We need this. Well, you want me to read it to you again? That's all you have to do. You have met your obligation to cooperate by telling them, I haven't normally done a damn thing wrong, and that's all I got to say. I'm not saying nothing else. That's all you have to say. So get word to your people. All right, let's go to land garden rights because we're running out of time. This is kind of like what goes along with the investigation there. You have the right to have a steward present if there's an investigatory interview. An investigatory interview is one where you think you might end up with this. If they call you in and you say, I want a steward, and they say, oh, you won't need a steward. You can ask them, well, can I possibly be disciplined for anything that I say? If they say yes, well, then I need a steward. If they say no, you say, okay, I want you to put that in writing. All right? So you have the right. So you say, okay, no, I don't need one. Okay, very good. The first question you ask me is, I want to know why you're outside the building today at 10:15, which is the time when you should have been inside on the machines. Guess what that is? That's an investigatory question. So you have the right to have a steward. So when they start asking you questions like that, don't let them tell you we're just having a talk. That's not a talk. So you have that right. You have the right to have shop steward. The problem we have a lot of times is people spill their guts before they ask for one. Sometimes they don't ask for one. And then if they ask for one, they don't get one. And then the postal inspector, whoever's conducting the investigation, they lie worse than we do. Postal inspector will lie worse than we do. They'll lie and say they didn't ask for one when they know damn well they did. Postal inspector will plant mail in your trunk if they just determine that you're the person that's taking mail. If they can't find any, they'll put it. God dang piece of mail in your trunk. I know. I've done cases with that. Where the only way that piece of mail could have gotten that trunk is when the postal inspector put it in there. That's a long story I don't have time to tell you. I've had cases where postal inspectors have placed cash and mail in the station, right out in plain sight, and people take it, and they see them take it from their little holes up in the ceiling, and they jump out of their little thing, and they shoot down their little small way, they come jump on the guy,
book them down,
can't find the damn money. Where's the money? We know you took it because I just saw you take it. I didn't take it back. They tore that damn post office apart, literally. I mean literally. And never did find that money.
Wow.
Still brought charges against me. Still brought charges against me. So, in that case, there wasn't anything left for them to plant any money because they tore it all apart with people that was watching. But if no one had been watching him, they would have planted some money in that cloakroom. Because when they watched him, he picked up that money, he went into that cloakroom, he came out of that cloakroom, they swooped down on him, took him inside, disrobed him, no money on him, had to be in that damn cloakroom. They literally tore that cloakroom out of the post office and did not find that money. And to this day, I don't know what that guy did.
Oh, he might have eaten it. He's inserted it somewhere. We won't mention where.
But anyway, they will plant stuff. Just like, you know, the police. They're out there at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. They see some young guys riding around or whatever. They're going to conduct a search. They're going to find some marijuana. They're going to find some something. Especially if you happen to be African American. They damn sure are going to find something.
Yep.
You know that. They lie.
Bridges.
Police lie. People in authority lie.
Yep.
Our government lies to us. Our postmaster general lies to us. Everybody lies to you. So, I don't feel bad at all about lying.
You're kidding.
Everybody lies.
Oh my God.
No. I do not feel
is that
bad
video
all
on?
My life.
Yes, it's on.
Turn that thing off.
Oh my cow.
Just do what you gotta do, just like that's what they do. I've been done arbitration.
I will edit that out.
Been done arbitration for 35 years. I have yet to hear a manager come on the stand and tell the truth. And I have a story I could tell you that emphasizes why we don't ask supervisors questions on the stand if we don't know what the answer has to be. I'll tell you real fast, even though it may make you stay over a little bit. I was doing a case in Springfield, Missouri, and local president wanted me to ask somebody a certain question. I said, I will not ask him that question because he'll lie. And so he won't lie. He's a God-fearing superintendent of Sunday school. He will not lie. As a matter of fact, he's told me he wants me to win this grievance. I said, I will not ask him that question because he will lie. He said, he will not lie. I insist you ask him that question because it will prove our case. And I said, I'm telling you right now, if I ask that question, he will lie and you will lose your case. He said, I don't care. I want you to ask him that question. I said, all right, I'll ask him that question. And as soon as you get the answer, I'm going to turn to you and say, told you so. Or, happy now? The question was, you put on this beautiful case to get a higher level salary grade for a register cage. Springfield, Missouri. Special postal clerk. We have them all over the country. Because those people should be special postal clerks. They should be higher level. So I asked the guy the question he wanted to ask. Do you believe that these people here should be higher level postal clerk instead of just clerk? And without batting an eye, after I swear to God, tell you the truth, whole truth, nothing but the truth, said, no, they're not going to hire them to work. Are you happy now? We lost the case. So, one time in my 35 years, never again, you don't ask a question of a manager, because some of it's going to lie. I don't care who he is. I don't care what. Matter of fact, we do cases. I've had managers tell me that a certain person was going to witness, but ended up not being a witness. And I talked to him later and found out, and it's because their advocate came in there and insists that they lie. And they refused to lie and say, I'm not going to do it. And so they said, well, then I won't use you. But their advocates will badger them to lie. So they lie. They all lie, no matter what. Miranda writes, you remain right to remain silent. You know what that is.